Let me introduce myself first. So I'm Nurhanun binti Ahmad Rastun. Okay. I'm a lecturer from UKM. And also we have another lecturer from UKM as well, this session. Okay, so I'm from Department of Biological Sciences and Biotechnology, FST UKM. So today I will give not lecture, just sharing on aptamer-based nanobiosensors. Actually, I prepared this slide. It's a quite simple, like you know, the basic introductions of aptamer. Okay, so I hope, may I know how many of you already, you know, familiar with aptamers?
Yes,
response from students. Okay, Siling, thank you for the response. All right, so for the introduction, okay, of course, we have to know what is aptamer first, okay? So basically, aptamers are oligonucleotide molecules, okay, capable of recognizing their own targets, okay, with high specificity and affinity. So it's basically the oligonucleotides, basically the DNA or RNA, around less than 1,000 base, right? So normally it's from 15 bases to 60 bases, the best aptamer sequence length. Okay, so the term aptamer is actually derived from Latin and Greek words, okay? Aptus means fit, and amerus means part, okay? Part or particles, okay? So similar to antibody, aptamers can bind to nucleic acid, proteins, small compounds, or even whole organisms such as virus, bacteria, and so on. Okay, so aptamers are identified using a technique called SELEX. It's from this word, okay, this systematic evolutions of ligands by exponential arrangement, called SELEX process. So basically, it was firstly discovered in 1990 by these three research groups, okay? So we can see the publications of these studies published in Nature and Science journals. So Twerk and Goh, and also Robertson and Joyce, they developed the technique called SELEX by producing oligonucleotides that can bind to their specific target. Okay, but later Ellington and Zostak coined the term of that oligonucleotides as aptamer. Okay, in the same year. All right. So here is the examples of aptamer to target interaction. Okay, as you can see here, RNA or DNA, single-stranded DNA oligonucleotides, okay, oligonucleotide strands, can fall into a specific structure. Okay, so this three structure of aptamer occur through intermolecular hybridizations, of course, because of the bases of the single-stranded DNA, all right? So which causes the folding of this aptamer into a particular shape. Okay, this is what we call the 3D structure, okay? Again, it depends on the bases, okay? We don't know what are the bases of what the sequence of aptamer, of the oligonucleotides, okay? Which can detect specific sites on our target, okay? Until we produce the aptamer through in vitro by using SELEX method. And also nowadays people tend to produce aptamer using in silico technique, okay? So there are two different technique of SELEX process, SELEX. One is in vitro and also in silico, all right? Okay, so because of this 3D structure of aptamer, specific structure, so it can only detect a specific site on our target, all right? Fit, okay? Bind and fit into specific site of the target. Okay, and also due to the flexibility and small size, the binding of this aptamer with the targets occur via non-covalent bond, okay, with the target, such as van der Waals, hydrogen bonding, electrostatic interactions, and even stacking on flat moieties like this one. Okay. The stacking mostly occurs between aptamer with small molecules target. Okay, and also shape complementary drive high affinity target binding. Okay, this one for bigger molecular weight of target. Okay, and I'm sure that most of you are familiar with the term antibody. Okay, in developing sensor. And how it works in biosensors. Well, actually, aptamer have also been known as synthetic antibodies or chemical antibodies because aptamer can be produced chemically. Okay, so that's why it got it names chemical antibodies. Okay, and here are the other properties of aptamers. It possesses a high affinity and specificity to its target and also rival to antibodies, can be produced just by chemical synthesis and because of its only oligonucleotides. So it can be easily or chemically modified and conjugated to numerous binding groups or nano materials, okay, for the sensor development. Okay, here, sorry. Aptamers, basically we always compare, okay, the advantage or the feasibility of using aptamers towards antibodies, okay? Because basically aptamers always have significant advantages over antibodies. It's likely that in the future, aptamer are expected, or even now, some of the aptamer already can be used as drugs and some still in clinical trial to replace antibody as drugs to treat some cancer disease. Okay, and that's why it's likely that they will replace antibody in near future for diagnostics and also therapeutic purpose. So from this table, you see the comparison between aptamer and antibody. Like for the first term, in terms of target range, okay, aptamer can be produced against almost anything. Means that we can produce aptamer to detect almost anything. But for antibody, very limited to its target, okay, that produce an immune response in a living organism only, all right? And the development time to produce the aptamer just within several weeks, okay? If we have no problems, technical problem during the production, of course. But for antibodies, because it involve the, you know, production of immune response and living organism, and it takes longer time, right? But the synthesis and manufacture produced in vitro and nowadays also in silico, but both techniques have their pros and cons, and the most popular technique is to produce aptamer using in vitro selection. Okay, and it's easier, much easier, because no animals used. But for antibodies, of course, we need to produce it within the animals. Then using recombinant methods, which take longer time. And then it's very low batch-to-batch variability. So the production cost is low, okay? Lower than the production cost for antibody, okay? Which have poor batch-to-batch reproducibility, okay? And again, it's chemically synthesized, okay? Excellent in QC, very easy, but for antibodies, more expensive. Okay, which more equipments needed. Okay, for handling and storage, okay, as we know, oligonucleotides are very stable, especially we can just use it at ambient temperatures and no freezing or refrigeration needed. But antibodies, in contrast, easily denatured. Okay, so it's very hard to modify the antibody. Okay, let's say we want to conjugate it with nanomaterials or change the design of the sensor because it's easily denatured, okay? So easier to use, much easier to use aptamers. stability, sitting, can withstand a repeated round of denaturation without loss of function. DNA, just DNA or RNA, stable in room temperature. But for antibodies made from proteins, easily denatured, losing structure function under wide range of condition. Okay, chef life, longer, and for antibody limited, of course, and only single use. But for ephthalmo, we can reuse it in some applications. It's stable, okay, and easy to modify. Okay. In terms of in vivo complications, ephthalmo, no intrinsic immune response. Okay, but for antibody, yes, it can cause immune response if used as a drug. Okay. And then for ephthalmo, functional under a broader range of condition defined by the customer base upon the intended end use, okay, for the assay development. But antibodies will only work under near physiological condition, okay, condition that are very similar to the origin condition in the body, right? And lastly, for ephthalmo, it has high affinity and greater potential for specificity due to the nature of the acceleration process. Okay, because during the production of ephthalmo, there are many, many steps involved to ensure that the single-stranded DNA, the oligonucleotide produced, is maintained the high specificity and affinity to be named as ephthalmo for that target. Right, it's not that easy, right? But for antibody, it has, of course, high affinity and good specificity to the target, but only to that particular antigen, right? Okay, so now we already know about the ephthalmo, what is ephthalmo, and also the advantage of ephthalmo. So why we need to produce ephthalmo? So the basic concept, a basic process of ephthalmo production in vitro selection. For this lecture, I will only cover about in vitro selection, not the in silico selection. All right. This selects process, the systematic evolution of ligands by exponential enrichment, is an interactive process, okay, which is required during ephthalmo selection, and it comprises of these four main steps: the binding step, elution step, PCR amplification step, phage steps. So actually, there are numbers of selects process developed. Okay, there are numbers of select process, in vitro selects process developed, which basically just differs in the material use and also technique use in the separation between the single-stranded DNA to the targets and so on. But all of these techniques basically consist of these four main steps, right? So for the first step, the binding step, okay, the binding of random library with target molecules. So in this process, ephthalmo library, okay, containing more than basically 10 to 15 random nucleotide sequences incubated with target, okay? And this step just happened at room temperature. We can do it at room temperature, okay? Because of the stability of the single-stranded DNA. But depends, if you target that are very sensitive to temperature, you might run this experiment in cold room and etc. And then ephthalmo library contain identical 10 to 15 sequence, the bases at 5 prime ends to and also at 3 prime ends as the primary region, forward primer and also reverse primer. This is very important region for amplification step. So we have to design this random library in order to get the ephthalmo sequence in the middle with X random region. Okay, and this strand consists of forward primer and reverse primer. All right, so the middle region, normally we put 30 to 60 random bases, okay? Depends on the size of the target. let's say for small molecule cases, small molecules, normally we just need 30 around. So 30 length of our tamo will be produced, 30 ml. But for proteins that have a bigger size, maybe more than 60 kilodalton, 100 kilodalton, we might need it. Longer random region. So this is about the design of the primary region for a random library. So during the interactions of single-stranded DNA library with target, many single-stranded DNA fails to recognize target. Means that it doesn't have any specificity or affinity to the target. Okay, but some have high affinity for target and they bind to it. For like, for instance, this one, okay, and this one, all right. And then the unbound single-stranded DNA are removed during the elution step, okay, by washing steps or maybe discarded using particles, okay, magnetic beads and maybe using graphene oxides, okay, just for the separation of single-stranded DNA with the target. Okay, that one is depends on the what kind of select process that we want to use. Okay, and then we have to quantify both unbound DNA and also the bound DNA to target. Okay, for each select round. Okay, so the eluted aptamer is amplified by polymerase chain reaction to amplify the single-stranded DNA that only bind to the target, right? So we only amplify the DNA that have high affinity and specificity to target because we already removed the unbound single-stranded DNA earlier during the elution step. So after PCR, we will get double-stranded DNA, and during page separation, we will convert the double-stranded DNA to single-stranded DNA in order to proceed to the next cycle, because only single-stranded DNA can be used for target binding. All right, so actually I have prepared this YouTube link, okay, for basic steps in selects and also one of the select types using magnetic bead based selects. Yeah, but maybe you can watch it later, all right? Because watch it later because we don't have much time. So, but for better understanding on how to produce aptamer, I suggest you to watch this movie animation, right? So again, I already mentioned earlier, there are so many selects type, okay? Blended selects, okay, chimeric selects, multi-stage select for producing aptamer, targeting more than one target. Okay, let's produce aptamer for tetracyclines, doxycyclines, and also oxytetracyclines on targets, but using just one selection step. Okay, multi-select can produce three different numbers at the same time. Okay, that's the difference. Again, SPR selects using SPR for DNA quantification, okay. Taylor condition, sol gel, using sol gel matrix, okay, for the separation and so on effects. So it's just a different different types of selects is because of the different material use and also the different technique used for the separation of oligonucleotide and target, right? Yeah. Okay, so the importance of having aptamer, okay, instead of using antibody or other probe, the bioreceptor such as antibody or enzyme, right? So for me, I'm very happy to use aptamer, okay, because nowadays aptamer has been used as a new molecular probe. Okay, so basically application, what we can do with aptamer is we can use aptamer for target purification. Okay, target purification using aptamer for affinity capturing, sorting, and also for target regulation, okay, for artificial ribose switch. And this one for target detection and monitoring, this is the biggest application of aptamer for molecular imaging, biosensors, sandwich type. Next for target inhibition, this one for drug delivery, drug discovery, and lastly for target characterization. This one mostly for, you know, the unknown, let's say we just newly discovered new molecules such as unknown protein, or we want to characterize it, so it's better to have aptamer to bind, you know, to put the tracking or, and so on. So this is the use of aptamer for characterization, a target preparation for target validation. So for this lecture, we will just focus on aptamer application in detection and monitoring, mostly on biosensors and also sandwich type, of course. Okay. So aptamer based nanobiosensor, I chose this topic because I just want to explain on the use of aptamer in biosensor. Of course, we can always sandwich aptamer with antibody, aptamer with enzyme, and so on. But for this lecture, I will just focus on the use of aptamer and how we can design. There are so many interesting design of biosensor by using aptamer. We'll show it to you all later. Okay, so for aptamer-based nanobiosensor, so the term is aptasensor, aptasensing. So basically, it's from the word aptamer and sensor. So aptasensor. Okay, so aptamer-based biosensors among various applications have exceptional merits, okay, compared to the natural receptors such as antibodies and enzymes. So these intrinsic properties of aptamers, their nucleic acid, has high flexibility of structure, convenient design of their structure, and also enable to develop the various novel aptasensor. So why aptamer as bioreceptor in nanobiosensors? Okay. So this is the reason. Okay. Because aptamers are even in complex form, okay, with targets, okay, we can easily amplify that sequence, that DNA, okay, by just using PCR. Okay, we don't need to separate it, okay, because PCR only, yeah, can amplify DNA, okay, very simple. So based on this property, a real-time PCR analysis and rolling circuit amplification, maybe some of you already know about rolling circuit amplification, okay, have been applied in aptasensors for signal amplification. So microarray platform also available for aptamer-based analysis. So in which this quantification of thousands of targets is possible by using microarray platform. And besides, any other nucleic acid detection methods can be adapted for aptasensors by combining both capturing and detection steps. So this is very important for sandwich type biosensor, okay, which make aptamer more and more important than antibody, right? Okay, second reason, because aptamer folds as well defined to researcher upon binding to the target. And their conformation are very flexible depending on the existence of the target molecules. And then third, the formation of aptamers can be easily modulated using the complementary sequences. Again, because it's only single-stranded DNA, okay? Whenever we know the sequence of the aptamer, we can also easily design the complementary sequence of the aptamer in order to make hybridization, yeah, during the as the probe, okay, for our sensor. Okay, so this aptamer complementary DNA complex can be easily destroyed by competitive interaction among aptamer. Always the aptamer to target affinity is bigger than the complementary hybridization bond, right? So that's why we can always use complementary DNA that complement to our target, to our aptamer sequence, okay, for detection of targets. Okay, so the complementary DNA and the target molecule, because the complementary DNA will be released, okay, will detach from our aptamer sequence upon addition of target. okay, because the interaction of aptamer to target is stronger than the interaction between single-stranded DNA aptamer with its complementary DNA. Okay, and then the design of complementary sequences should be depending on the sequence of aptamer and their affinity with target sophisticatedly. And then these unique properties of aptamers on the flexible conformational change added a few novel methods in the signals generations on different formats of biosensors, such as simple binding or sandwich type. Okay, so these approaches are considered to be very powerful, especially for the detection of the small molecule targets, since sandwich type assay format and mass-dependent detection methods such as SPR, okay, label-free, very well-known assay, okay, to detect small molecules or even larger protein by using SPR or QCM, okay, because they are not possible due to their for small molecular size, okay, better to use QCM and SPR. Because by using aptamer, okay, let's say we have more than one probe that can bind to a single target on different sites of that part of that target, we can increase the signal generation. Okay? And then lastly, the reason why we need aptamer is because the easy modification and labeling of dyes or functional groups at the end or inter-sites of the aptamer sequence. Okay, this is to establish the aptamer-based assay format in terms of the signal generation and the well-oriented immobilization on solid support. So, actually, this is the other advantage of using aptamer for target detection, where we can produce dual aptamers. Okay? Actually, the term dual aptamers means two aptamers that can bind to two different sites on our target, right? So we call it dual aptamer. So the advantages of using dual aptamers in APTA sensors are, number one, easy and highly amplified signals can be generated from the use of secondary signaling aptamer. Okay? And second, sandwich type, of course, possible to be used, right? And lastly, the realization of APTA sensors in markets are now very close to the use of antibody, what we have used nowadays in lab, okay, for research, the ELISA, and also any other antibody-based sandwich assays. So the importance of having sandwich type biosensors are various types of signal generation, signal development on wide range of material platform can be designed and developed. Okay. Here, let's think of having more than one probe that can recognize our target. So first probe can act as a capturing probe and the other can act as signaling probe. So capturing probe can be easily modified and conjugated on different types of nanoparticles or nanomaterials such as chip or gold nanoparticle, for example, here, and paper base, okay, and so on, fiber. And for a signaling probe can be used to enhance the signal generation, again, by conjugating it with different kinds of nanomaterials such as quantum dot, gold nanoparticle, and so on. Okay. So based on the advantages of aptamer, as I've mentioned earlier in the previous slide, so aptamer is very important as a new molecular probe, okay? So I'm sure that most of you are very familiar with this figure, with this slide, okay, as a biosensor person, all right? So this is basically the overall strategies of biosensor design. So I will just go through very briefly. So in order to develop any sensor platform or device, of course, we must know what we want to detect, right? Okay, so let's start from here. So our target molecules, it might be virus or protein, cell or small molecules, what we want to detect, okay? Then the second step is we should consider what kind of bioreceptor to be used, okay? Such as antibody and enzyme. And now, okay, we know about aptamer, right? So some of target molecules do not have readily available antibody or enzyme as their bioreceptors. So here, the aptamer production for these targets are really needed, right? Then we have to think about the design of biosensor in the terms of what technique we want to implement, right? Using what kind of sensing modalities, optical or electrochem or fluorescent, okay? And what kind of technique we want to use, the materials involved for immobilization or maybe immobilization-free, using beads, chips, and others materials. And then lastly, okay, after we already developed this sensor, okay, and stabilize it, and then we have to think how can we amplify the signals, okay? By using single binding type or sandwich type, or maybe using amplification techniques by using enzyme link, other particles involved, and also other amplification process involved. Okay, so these will only be realized by using a sandwich type. And of course, we need to have more than one probe that can bind to one single target. So this is the best thing about aptamer actually, right? Okay, oh, what's this? Okay, all right, sorry. Okay, so here are some examples of readily available biosensor devices in market, now using antibody still, okay? But I'm sure that we can replace it with aptamer, okay, sooner or later. And that I'm sure you are familiar with, such as this test strip for pregnancy tests and HIV tests. Okay, and PGM for diabetic patients, and most popular lead-based sandwich assay, okay, ELISA, and also cheek-based for dengue tests, and also the if you had ever heard about for COVID-19 virus, they produce cheek-based sensor, but that one using antigen or and also antibody as the bioreceptor, okay, but using cheek-based sensor. All right. So for this lecture, I have prepared three most popular aptamer-based biosensors in which to show how versatile the aptamer is, and it can be used in varieties of signal generation mode. Okay, number one, colorimetric aptasensing. Second, fluorimetric aptasensing. And third, electrochemical aptasensing. So let's see the first one, colorimetric aptasensing. So these are the summarized, okay, of all the techniques that you can use for colorimetric aptasensing by using aptamer. Okay, just simply choose which one you want to use, right? All right, so the first one, okay. Actually, this colorimetric aptasensing can be used by using both modified or unmodified gold nanoparticles, okay? Modified gold nanoparticle means that the gold nanoparticles are pre-conjugated with aptamers or probe before the addition of target. Before the binding steps, okay? So let's see one by one. The figure A, okay, about sandwich type colorimetry aptasensor using dual aptamers, okay? So in this design, gold nanoparticle are pre-conjugated with two different aptamers, okay, that can bind to this target. Means that this target already have a dual aptamer, aptamer number one and aptamer number two, okay? So can bind to this particular target. All right. So upon addition of target, both aptamer binds to the target on the different sides. Okay. So it makes the gold nanoparticle to aggregate, okay, and change color from red to purple. Okay. And then let's see the second technique. Okay. By using target-induced displacement of aptamer from AUMP's network. Sorry, the spelling error. Okay, so in this design is in reverse way from the A design. Okay, so upon addition of target, the aptamers that were partially hybridized on complementary sequence. Okay, the complementary sequence was pre-conjugated on a gold nanoparticle. Okay, so aptamer sequence, the black color, okay, as you can see here. So upon addition of the target, so aptamer sequence will detach and bind to target. So it caused the higher distance of goal to goal, goal to goal distance. So change the color from purple to red. Okay, so C is about the aggregation of AUMP via surface condition, okay, by adding anion salt. Okay, and same goes to D design. Okay, but the D design use unmodified AUMP. Okay, so and lastly, about the target induced assembly of aptamer fragments, where folded aptamer cannot interact with gold nanoparticle. Okay. So upon addition of target, the aptamer will fold into its structure, the 3D structure, and it cannot bind to gold nanoparticle. So this gold nanoparticle will aggregate and cause the color changes from red to purple. So these are all the the design of probe that we can use, okay, in order to create a signal, okay, using colorimetric aperture sensing. Okay, next. Okay, next is about the fluorometric aperture sensing by using gold nanoparticle as fluorescence quencher. So basically, we use this. This is just an example using gold nanoparticle. We can also use other material such as graphene oxide also as the fluorescence quencher. So when the fluorophore, okay, the distance between fluorophore with the particle is very close, so it's quenched, so we cannot see the signal of the fluorescence. But upon addition of target, okay, the aptamer will bind to target, releasing the this DNA probe labeled with fluorophore, so we can see the fluorescent signal, okay, with the presence of target. Okay, B is about target-induced displacement of aptamer from non-labeled complementary DNA. Okay, same thing, but aptamer, the DNA probe will be conjugated on the nanoparticle, and then aptamer will be releasing out upon binding to the target, okay, and then cause the fluorescence signal to be detected. And then lastly, target-induced conformational changes of aptamer and detached from unmodified gold nanoparticle. This one using unmodified gold nanoparticle. So easily detached from the gold nanoparticle upon binding to the target, and then we can see the signal. Okay, so this for fluorescent, fluorometric aperture sensing. And then lastly, about the electrochemical aperture sensing. Okay, basically for electrochemical assay based on sandwich format, okay, by using dual aptamer, like from A design, okay, and also aptamer with probe DNA hybrid using complementary DNA for B and C, okay, same thing, okay, but we attach it to electrode, okay, so, but here it will give highly enhanced signal, okay, for the electrochemical sensing, after sensing, right? So the same thing, and yeah. Okay, so here I also prepared, we still have time. Sorry, okay, this is just, I have prepared a case study on my research, okay, on producing the production of aptamer for VASPIN, okay, for VASPIN detection, which basically VASPIN is a protein involved in diabetes, okay, one of the biomarker for type 2 diabetes, right? So VASPIN is actually still we don't know the function of VASPIN in causing the disease. So that's why at that time it's very important to have aptamer so that we can characterize this protein, right? To know more about the molecular maybe properties of this protein and also the function of the protein involved in the disease, right? So this case study covers these four cover these four topics, VASPIN aptamer selection, first been aptamer characterization and then aptamer engineering. Aptamer engineering in this in the Vaspin case still actually for aptamer engineering we only do in small molecule cases, okay, because to produce shorter aptamer sequence for small molecules. Okay, as we know that from my explanation earlier, when we want to produce aptamer through SELECT process, we have to have already primer forward primer region, reverse primer region which already consists of how many, around 40 bases there. Okay, so it takes longer portion of the aptamer sequence itself. So we have to do the aptamer engineering for small molecules to produce shorter sequence of aptamer for small molecule cases. Okay, and then lastly about the Vaspin aptamer amplification. So here, okay, I've already explained about the SELECT process. Okay, the basic steps involved. So here I will explain in detail. Okay, this is the technique, SELECT technique that I really love to use. Okay, I have experience using FluMag SELECT, means using magnetic bead SELECT, and also cell SELECT, using cell to produce for bacteria, aptamer for bacteria, and also its proteins. Okay, but for GO SELECT, it's very versatile and easy to use. So that's why I like to use more. Okay, so GO basically is from graphene oxide. It means that I use the graphene oxide materials in this SELECT. Okay, and the advantage of this SELECT technique is it involves immobilization free. Okay, it means that we don't have to immobilize the DNA or even protein, our target in this case protein, to the material. We don't have to, but for FluMag SELECT like magnetic bead, you have to conjugate it, okay, avidin binding, okay, something like that. So it's very hard to you know, once you already conjugate the protein or the targets on material surface, we already lose the surface, you know, on the protein, okay, to be bound to the target, right, to the aptamer, sorry. Okay, so in this case, immobilization free screening of aptamers are very important, so that we already we give full exposure of the targets to be selected by single stranded DNA during the selection process. Okay, so first here the counter selection. Okay, this is the new one, the new step. I didn't explain about counter selection in previous slides, but counter selection process is very important steps at the beginning of the selection process, selection cycles. In here, we instead of just using, okay, let's say my target here is Vaspin, right? Vaspin. So I will also incubate the DNA, single-stranded DNA library with other proteins that are closely related to Vaspin. It means that it's also involved in diabetes, okay, patient, yeah, as biomarker, diabetic biomarker, such as adiponectin, okay, the proteins involved, and also human serum, so that we can eliminate all the non-specific binding of single-stranded DNA. Okay, so this is a very important step to ensure that we can produce high affinity aptamer to our target. So first, we incubate the random library with counter targets. Okay, it might be 4, 5, or 6 other proteins. Okay, and then in here we will discard the counter target. Okay, because actually graphene oxide, interestingly, single stranded DNA can bind to graphene oxide. Okay, only single stranded DNA by pi-pi stacking. Okay, so but it's not too strong, right? So upon addition of counter targets, okay, this single-stranded DNA will detach out from the graphene oxide, okay, through affinity-based binding. Okay, whenever any single-stranded DNA that have affinity to the target or counter target, it will detach out from the graphene and bind to targets. So we can easily remove this. Counter targets with the single-stranded DNA that bind to it through separation, just centrifugation. Okay, and then we remove the serpentin and we keep the graphene oxide at the bottom of the tube, okay, through centrifugation. And then after that, we add our target. So again, we already remove some portion of the single-stranded DNA that we don't need, okay, and then we add our target. In this case, my Vaspin. Vaspin. So once I add the Vaspin, okay, Vaspin, I will recover the DNA that bind to Vaspin, okay, and then this only this strain will undergo amplification. Okay, so I will remove all the unnecessary single-stranded DNA. Okay, so we'll I will only amplify this single-stranded DNA bind to Vaspin using PCR and then page to separate again double-stranded DNA into two single-stranded DNA. And then this cycle will be repeated until, okay, this is the picture of how the separation between double-stranded DNA after PCR amplification, okay, to form the single two strands of single-stranded DNA, okay, by using PAGE, okay. So we can just take, okay, this is one strand and then this is the second strand. So we can just cut this gel and then proceed with next round, lah. All right. Okay, so that this cycle will be repeated. Okay, this is, let's say, first round. Okay, we put 100% of single-stranded DNA. So first round is normally about 1 to 3% the recovered DNA. So we only amplify this one. Okay, the single-stranded DNA that have high affinity to our target. Again, we amplify and use it for the second round. And then again, for the third round, until we reach the equilibrium state. Okay, the saturation state. So let's say we already reached the saturation state and we took this sample and then clone and then we can see the sequence after we send out for sequencing, right? So we will know the sequence of our aptamer. So from this aptamer, from this Vaspin aptamer selection, okay, I successfully recovered, how many I have forgot already. Okay, we want to get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay, 11 different sequences of aptamer candidates. Okay. Okay, so actually this is from 50 different 50 sequences, I mean 50 colonies that have been sent out for sequencing. Okay, so from 50 sequences. Okay, V1, I can't remember the exact number, but it's around maybe from 50, maybe 20, some 20 sequence have the same sequences. I mean, 20 sample have the same sequences, okay? Means that it's very specific to the target, okay? Bind to the target. Okay, so from this 11 aptamer candidates, firstly, we have to characterize it whether it has specificity to Vaspin or not. Okay, so we run SPR, okay, and check the relative response unit from the SPR signal. Okay, so we only select the aptamer candidate that has no binding to other proteins. Okay, so in this case, only 4 aptamer. V1, V4, V14, and V49, okay, has very slight, okay, non-specific adsorption, but very high specificity to the target. So this is how we characterize the aptamer, okay. And then next, proceed with these 4 aptamer candidates. We check the affinity test, okay, check the KD value, okay, how strong the aptamer targets bind, right. And then let's. Because in this case, okay, I have 4 different sequence of aptamer that can bind to one single target. Okay, so I check whether this aptamer can work as dual aptamers or not. Okay, so basically, I use SPR. Okay, so first primary aptamer can be V1 or V4, V14. Just check everything. Okay, and then target, and then I will put a second aptamer. So if I have I got any signal from the SPR reading, so means that this combination is working well, all right. And then after that, we also check with CD spectrum to check whether the dual binding is occur or not. Okay, so here from the CD spectrum, you can see that from the first binding, okay, only the spectrum. pattern is like this, but for the addition of second aptamer, we can see the changes of the pattern. So it confirmed that the this dual aptamer can bind to different site of protein. Okay, and then again check the fluorescence. Okay, this is just for characterization. Okay, only buffer with V49 as signaling probe. Okay, we cannot see any signal. Okay, because no capturing probe. Okay, and then this is no VASPIN. Okay, and then with VASPIN, but with different aptamer. Okay, BVDV aptamer. And this is aptamer for virus. Okay, but we cannot see any signal. But with the combination of V49 and also V1 aptamer, okay, we can see the signal. Okay, means that the sandwich bind occurred. Okay, and then I think still have time. Okay, next. Okay, again, I've explained earlier that aptamer have quite long unnecessary region. We call it unnecessary region because of the known primer sequences. All right. So what we can do is we can do aptamer engineering. We call it truncation process. Right. So in this case, I haven't test or run a truncation experiment by using my aptamer sequence yet. Okay, VASPIN, but I did with small molecule case for tetracycline antibiotics. Okay, tetracyclines, oxytetracyclines, doxycyclines. So for antibiotics. So in this case, for aptamer engineering, okay, as I have said earlier, the unnecessary regions exist. Okay, the for primer and also reverse primer. So this is the random region, the very important region. Okay, so it is because of the PCR region and also long sequence. So what we can do, we need to optimize this sequence by removing the primer region. That's the first step. But somehow we have to check through multiple sequence alignment, because sometimes the primer region also involved in the binding of aptamer to target. Okay, so that one is, you know, heuristically we have to check, right? And then how to optimize engineering. So the purpose of engineering is to find the core sequence and remove unnecessary region, because this is to enhance the affinity of aptamer and increase the sensitivity of aptasensor. Okay, so these are the example of research studies that have been done on engineering of aptamer. Okay, first, this paper said that from the aptamer sequence, okay, let's say we fold it into 2D structure, so we can know the G quadruplet regions. So mostly this G quadruplet region have a better or higher affinity to target. Okay, and then this paper said that from the secondary structure, the stem loop region. Okay, and then this one also say about the stem loop region. So we focus on this region once we get our aptamer sequences. All right. So for example, in this study, when they remove other sequence and they maintain the G quadruplet region from the aptamer sequences, they said that it binds with 20 to 50 fold higher affinity than original sequence, right? So, and stem loop, okay, this is the stem loop region, and they remove this part, okay, they only recover the stem loop region, okay, this one, one and two, and then stem loop multiplication in the study, this is the overall aptamer sequence, and they only take the stem loop. Okay, sorry, this is not the overall. They didn't put it here. Okay, but they only take the stem loop region and multiply it. Okay, they link it with linker and then multiply it to produce new aptamer sequence, but only with stem loop region. Okay. All right. So in my case, in my study for chemical case, okay, this paper actually been published by my senior. Okay, they produce single stranded DNA aptamers that selectively bind to oxytetracyclines. But from their papers, we check that the some of DNA sequence have high affinity to oxytetracyclines. From here, we want to know by using multiple sequence alignment, okay, we check the conserved region of these several uptown sequences. So here we can screen that three site A, B, and C types of aptamer that might have the core sequence of the aptamer for pre-screening. So from here, okay, we luckily, okay, this paper published in 2014, okay, luckily we managed to get, we successfully get the calorimetric detection of tetracyclines using the shortest aptamer, okay, with highly enhanced affinity. Okay, we can enhance the affinity of the aptamer detection, tetracycline detection. Okay, this is the original aptamer. Okay, but by using truncated aptamer, okay, it enhanced. Okay, but we lose the specificity. Okay, that's the limitation of truncation. Okay, if we're lucky enough, we can get also the high specificity. But it depends on what purpose we want. Okay, for this study, we actually want to detect in the group. Tetracyclines group, okay, not the specific monomers, okay. So, okay, and also from paper, if you can remember, Profaza, the paper from Farah Asila, okay, for zearalenone. Yes. She implemented this technique, and then she managed to get aptamer with high affinity. But also lose the specificity. But it's okay because the purpose is to detect the group of zearalenone. Okay. All right. So lastly, about the aptamer application. So next generation biosensing. I already explained earlier about the sandwich type and aptamer pair sandwich type. And if we have more than two aptamer, okay, dual aptamer or three aptamers that can bind, okay, so we can easily modify, okay, to enhance the signal. All right, so for VASPIN case, what I did, I use SPR, okay, for VASPIN aptamer sensing. So first probe conjugated on the chip, VASPIN chip, gold chip, and then VASPIN. And then for second probe signaling, I conjugated with gunana particle to enhance the SPR signal, right? So we can see like this. Single aptamer, just very low signal, and then we can enhance the signal. Up to from 399 nanogram per ml, okay, to 3.5 nanogram per ml, the sensitivity. And then, interestingly, by using this dual aptamer system, VASPIN can be detected in the physiological range of interest, right? And lastly, I use lateral flow straight aptamer sensor, okay, same with pregnancy test, okay, just to easily detect VASPIN by using test strip, right? And this is the results, right? Okay, so this is my last slide, I think, about the global aptamer market. So actually, there are emerging of companies that produce aptamer and also offers to offer services to produce aptamer and also to produce targets that that can be easily used to develop aptamer and also sensor. So and also from the publication from the beginning of the production of aptamer 1990 okay, up to now, this is the until 2015, increasing rapidly, okay, in the publication, also the application of aptamer, and number of publication also increasing. So this means that aptamer nowadays is very important, but you know, if we don't produce aptamer for that particular target, we cannot use, okay, this aptamer sensor. So it's very important also for somebody to really know and involve in production of aptamer research, okay? Because this company actually, well, they want, let's say, the service to produce one single aptamer for one single single target very costly. It's very, very expensive. Last time it's around 10 million Korea won. It's about, I forgot how to, but it's more than 50,000, okay, ringgit Malaysia, okay, just to produce one single atom. It's very expensive. I will be very rich person like, if I can offer this service, you know. All right, so that's all from me. Thank you so much.
All right, a very comprehensive and impressive lecture, Dr. Hanan. Okay, I will only allow a brief two short questions if from the floor.
Hi, good morning, Prof.
Yes, hi, Jo.
Yeah, I have a question that based on the page 5, you share that all this is the advantage of the atoms towards the antibody. So is it any limitation or the advantage of antibody instead of, better than atoms?